This section of the book is on calculating volumes of solids that are sitting in space using integration. Like a lot of the topics in applications of integration, we would be able to do more general examples in multivariable calculus, when we have calculus with many functions of many variables. But still, even though this is single variable calculus, where our functions are just like functions of x, we can handle lots of interesting examples of calculating volumes. So let's just, suppose you've got some solid. I'm drawing something arbitrarily weird, but we won't handle something like this. It's just to make a point. So you've got some solid object sitting in space, and it's set up a coordinate axis, or suppose you've got a coordinate axis, and I'll just call it x, but it doesn't matter. And somehow, and we're going to look at some examples of how, but somehow you know that the cross-sectional area, when you take cross-sections perpendicular to this axis, so when you take planes that are perpendicular to this axis that you've picked, you know the area of the cross section that it slices out of your solid. So you're at some x coordinate x, and we're assuming that for each x coordinate between, say, this end of the solid is at A, this end is at B, and we're assuming for every x coordinate between A and B, if you take a plane perpendicular to this axis and look at where it slices the solid, that you know the area of this cross-sectional slice, A of x equals the area of the x cross-section of your solid. Right? Suppose you have that data. The question is, then how would you get the volume? And the answer, thinking infinitesimally, is that you fatten this up a little bit. You take an infinitesimal change in x, or really, you take Riemann sums where you partition the interval from A to B up into lots of things. But thinking infinitesimally, we take a small change in x, and we take that cross-sectional area, and then we fatten it up a little bit by that infinitesimal change in x. I am not trying to draw the cross sections as though they're all circles or disks. So you get some thickened cross-sectional slice. It has some volume, namely some infinitesimal little volume, dv. Volume. And it's infinitesimal volume. That's actually a really bad picture. Its infinitesimal volume is just the area times this thickness, this dx. So it's just A of x times dx. And of course, to find the total volume, what you want to do is take a continuous sum of all of those infinitesimal volumes as x goes over all the coordinates, the x coordinates of your solid. So this means you want to take the integral from A to B of A of x dx. Great. So that's what you do. You look at cross-sectional slices, which I seem to have drawn all as circles. It's easiest. You thicken them up a little bit, and you get ax times dx for the infinitesimal volume, and then you add those up. Great. So that's what you do. So let's go ahead and look at a fairly, complicated, but not so complicated, but interesting example, where you may know this formula from geometry, you may not. let's take a rectangle that's sitting at some specific height. So I'm going to call this the z-axis, the x-axis down here, and the y-axis here, although I won't really use anything except z. Suppose I've got some rectangle that's sitting at a fixed height, capital H. So that rectangle lies in the plane at z equals h. And then I connect that rectangle to the origin. So I take a look at, so I'm thinking of this as filled in, and then I draw all the line segments connecting the points in this rectangle to the origin. So what you get is a pyramid, it just happened, or a slanted pyramid that happens to be upside down. Let me draw this. Okay. Let's fix this picture so that it looks. I need to draw it more slanted so it doesn't, or maybe less slanted would be good. So it doesn't, we don't confuse the lines connecting it with the edges of the rectangle. Let's do this. We'll go with more slanted. Okay, so you've got this. Okay, I got a little carried away. You've got this slanted pyramid that's also upside down. It's got a rectangular base, and then it's connected, its vertex is at the origin. That's just for ease of setting it up. Clearly, if we're finding volume, it doesn't matter which way it's oriented, so I've just oriented it the way I find most convenient. So the cross sections, if we take z cross sections, so you fix a cross section at a particular z coordinate, take a plane perpendicular to the z-axis, it will cut this in a rectangle that, well, you probably have never talked about similar rectangles, but it looks like a rectangle that's similar to that one, to the base. Okay, so this rectangle. And let's say the area of this base is B. All right, what we'd like is a formula for the area of this cross-sectional rectangle that I called similar to this rectangle that's the base. We need a formula in terms of z for its area, and then we'll just integrate. How do you get, this has x's in it, but it doesn't matter, we can use z's. So how do you get such a formula? All right, well, let me just say what's going to happen, and then we'll verify that it's true. But I claim is that a of z, the area of the z cross section, is proportional to z squared. So proportional to means equals a constant times. So I claim it equals some constant times z squared. Why is that true? Well, you actually use similar triangles but you have to use kind of two sets of similar triangles. So for instance, let's call this side of the big rectangle, the base, let's call that L. It's some fixed number. But let's call the side of this cross-sectional rectangle that corresponds to that side, let's call that length L, little l of z. right? It changes with z. Well, I claim that from similar triangles, L of z is proportional to z, so that when z is 0, you get 0. When z is when z is h, you get L. So you can figure out the proportionality constant. How do you see that L of z is proportional to z? The answer is you use similar triangles. But what similar triangles? Well, you have to use a couple of pairs of them. This would be a good exercise. But if you take, say, this triangle, and then you take this triangle, all right. These two triangles, this big triangle here and this little triangle here, are similar. So the ratio of this length to this length, but this length is z, this length is h, the ratio of this length to this length is the same as the ratio of this length to this length. All right. So the ratio of this to this, so z over h, is the same as the ratio of, I guess I'll give them names temporarily, A, and call this short one A, and the long one B. Oops, I already used A and B. Okay, not A and B, C and D. This would be C over D, or I guess if I'm sticking with capital letters, C over capital D. Capital letters for these fixed lengths, little letters for the ones that change when z changes. On the other hand, now that you've got it's the ratio of, same as the ratio of this to this, that by these similar triangles, if you look at this triangle, so one of the faces of the pyramid, and this triangle, those are similar triangles, and the ratio of this to this is the same as the ratio of this little L that we were after to this big L. So what you see in the end is that, yeah, the z over h equals little L over capital L, where I'll remind you capital L is what I called this side. So the point is that little L, which is a function of z, so you can ignore this intermediate one, little L of z, as a function of z is capital L, just multiply both sides by capital L over h times z. In particular, it's some constant times z. But you can do the same thing for this other dimension. That was this little L, but you can do the exact same thing for the width, and it too will be proportional to z. And then when you multiply the length times the width, you get the area, and it'll be a constant times z times a constant times z. It'll be a constant times z squared. All right. In fact, you know, it's kind of a very believable principle if you believe in such things as similar rectangles, that rectangles have two dimensions. And if they're proportional, then that means the length and the width should be proportional, which should mean that the area is proportional to z squared. Anyway, now that we know the area is proportional to z squared, we can figure out the proportionality constant. It's true, it's just what I would call capital L times capital W, but that's the area of the base, which we called B. So, right, if we know that A of z is proportional to z squared, so equals some constant times z squared, but we know that when z is capital H, we get the area of the base, right? Because the cross section at height H has area B, that's what we called it, but that has to equal then k times H squared. So there's no question what the proportionality constant is. You just divide both sides by H squared and you get A is b over h squared. So our formula for the cross-sectional area is a of z equals b over h squared times z squared. And in general, in these problems where you're trying to find volumes by fattening up cross-sections, the typical problem is how do you find a formula for the cross-sectional area? Doing the integration, well, it's as hard as the functions are hard to integrate, but you know, the actual obtaining of this cross-sectional area formula is the hard part. Now the actual calculation of the volume is easy. The volume, we would integrate as z goes from 0 to h of a of z dz. So these thickened up cross-sectional slices, you add up all their infinitesimal little volumes, we get the integral from 0 to h of b over h squared z squared dz. B and h are constants, so b over h squared is a constant. We can pull that out. Use the power rule on z squared. It's antiderivative, z cubed, or an antiderivative, z cubed over 3. And you evaluate as z goes from 0 to h. So you plug in h for z and subtract what you get at 0. At 0, you get 0. At h, you get b over h squared times h cubed over 3. And h squared cancels, and you're left with 1/3 of the area of the base times